Hi, this is Dr. Nemechek again. I want to talk about how the body goes out of its way to do everything possible to keep the brain healthy and alive. All right? And as a species, and I think most species are like this, the brain, and this is called selfish brain theory, where your entire physical existence, okay, the thirst you feel, the sleep you need, the hunger you have is primarily to keep your brain alive, all right? Not just alive, but really healthy at your peak shape. Because if you think about all the different organs, so the brain's an organ, your heart, your liver, your kidney, your intestinal tracts, right? You can have a little heart failure and be alive. You can have a little kidney problem, be alive. Your intestinal tract may not work right and be alive. But if you're a primitive stone age human, hunter-gatherer, whatever you want to call them, and your brain doesn't work right, right? You can't think, you can't focus, you can't feed yourself, you're going to die. Okay, so the very practical reason for this is with selfish brain theory and so forth, all your physical functioning is to keep your brain alive. All right, now, what's kind of interesting is we have these, and I talked about this in another video, when you're young, you have these chemicals that do this awesome job of repairing the brain, and they're loosely referred to as rejuvenation chemicals. We lose this as we get older, all right? And so we're really, through an evolutionary standpoint, to a large extent designed to survive and be healthy till we can procreate and make more humans, right? That's a critical part of a species, is to, you know, expand the population. And then you have to, after you have children, you have to stay alive to help them grow, because we have this long kind of vulnerability of the humans. And then older individuals kind of a failure of engineering to some degree, all right? But older individuals are needed, not so much in a physical standpoint, and again, this is from an evolutionary perspective, because they were the repositories of memory. They knew migration patterns, they knew weather patterns, they knew the stars, they knew what plants and foods to eat, what not to eat, and so they would be kept around, essentially, in the tribe, because after around, I've read, around maybe 35, 40, it's hard for an individual to go hunt and gather and get all the food they need just for themselves, let alone for other people. So beyond 40, an individual kind of becomes a burden. So the brain is maintained in a very fit state, okay, even though physically they aren't as adept at hunting, but to provide like a library of knowledge for the clan or the tribe or the village, however you want to look at that. So now, and it's kind of interesting, as we get older, and I just experienced this, I was with some of my friends, all right, and these have been my friends for 50, 55 years, my closest, dearest friends. I look at all of us around, we're all aging, we're changing, some have problems, when one guy's got a hip implant, another guy had a little cancer, another this and that, so there's little things happening to everybody. But when we talk to one another, our brains feel like we're 18. My thoughts are that clear. My brain is that fresh. All right. It's just the external aspect is aging, but really the brain is not. All right. If everything's working right, and part of what I do is help make things work right again. All right. And so the body is taking a lot of damage, and for the most part, the brain remains very fit and very youthful, if you want to look at it that way, even though we aren't youthful on the outside. Now, there's a very stark example of this. And in World War II, we had these horrible internment camps in Nazi Germany and in Russia too, as far as I remember. And basically, people were being starved to death there. At the end of the war, these people were liberated. Unfortunately, some still went on to die, and they would do postmortems of these people, basically autopsies. And what they found was rather startling. And because of the starvation, their hearts would be small and shrunken because the body would be eating protein that was heart muscle. All right, the body will devour the heart. The liver is small. The kidney is small. They have no muscle mass. The body is completely devouring all these organs. But when they would remove the top of the skull and examine the brain, they reported that these brains looked perfectly healthy, that they were in pristine shape. So it is a stark visual example of what happens in this hierarchy that we call selfish brain theory, where everything about your physiology is meant to keep your brain alive up until the last breath you take. Okay? And so that's just kind of a little insight of how your physiology runs, how the brain is being managed, and how critical it is for us to maintain our overall inflammatory omega health and gut bacteria health, the things that I'm commonly promoting in terms of doing this. So hope you find that interesting. I love the topic, and y'all have a great day. This is Dr. Patrick Nemechek of Nemechek Autonomic Medicine in Buckeye, Arizona. Take care now. Bye.